Hi, as Scooch mentioned, I'm Oren. You may have also heard of me from the third longest running internet argument, also known as Twitter. If you're curious, the first two are Usenet and IRC, respectively. By day, I'm founder and principal consultant at IR Limited, and we're a DevOps consultancy based here in Wellington. And one of the core things we work on is ensuring the success of technical change by helping our clients on the cultural side of the DevOps journey. And DevOps has been a really interesting journey for me. This is a journey that started with a focus on technology. And while technology is very cool, one of the core things I've learned over the last few years is that it's also a complete head fake. And if you've not heard that term before, I learned it from Dr. Randy Posh's The Last Lecture. Dr. Posh was a lecturer and researcher in the 90s, and he used this term in his talk to describe offering his students one thing, often tools, with the goal of getting them to think about something completely different. So when I say DevOps is a head fake, I'm saying that these excellent tools aren't the goal. They're not even the most interesting part of what I do. Instead, we're using these tools to drive significant cultural change. The tools ask us to change how we view the needs of the people that aren't on our team, who don't know what we know, but do know things that we don't know. And this is the name, like the portmanteau of developer and operations. It's asking us to break down walls of separation, see our skills on a spectrum, asking, how do I make your life easier? But crucially, it asks us to help others to belong. Because there's always been that hard split between devs and ops. Our culture taught us to do that. Our culture defines the other side as interlopers, unable to do what we do, as lesser. From the dev side of things, operations is held as less skilled, less important. The attitude is that because sysadmins don't know how to code, like really code, their opinions aren't worth paying attention to. All operations is there for is to wire up the bits, not do the real creative work, the important work of developing and architecting a system. They do nothing more than maintain things made by other people. By contrast, devs are referred to as inept and unable to be trusted with any level of systems privilege because they will wreck things, make things harder for ops. After all, the devs don't know what it's like at 3 a.m. when production is down and the boss is screaming and everything is on fire. You know, devs just want to log in and make that one change. And they have no concept of the difficulty that that entails. And historically, no group has really belonged to the other. Each has had their own culture and attitudes. And that split harms others' DevOps journeys, struggling by being seen by ops as a dev, and all of the bumbling fool that that entails. Being seen by devs as ops, and all of the, well, she's just ops, she doesn't know how to code. Disregarding that DevOps is a new and unique set of skills. And a lot of this behavior derives from contempt culture, which you may have heard me talk about before. And for those that haven't, contempt culture is the idea that we gain status in our communities through displays of contempt toward things that our community has deemed as inferior. For devs as a whole, this is positioning ops as inferior, or ops is not coding, less complex than the art and craft that is coding, which means that they are ultimately unworthy of our time. Ops have similar contemptuous displays, most visibly prominent being loser. Devs have taken this one up too. Or the 1D10T error, or the problem exists between keyboard and chair error, or the LART, the loser attitude readjustment tool. Think a 2x4 to the head. Or the stories of the BOFH, which has been running since the late 80s. These are catharsis, the wish fulfillment of visiting harm on being forced to serve those that are beneath our station. But this is only a slice of the culture that we exist in. And we show we belong when we perform it. We claim that we are valid parts of the conversations, that we have our own war stories of 3 a.m. wake-up calls. And it's all because we know the right stuff, right? Well, I lied a little bit. I said the contempt culture is how we gain status through displaying through acts of contempt. But it's more nuanced than that. It's also showing that we desire to be a part of the group. It shows that I am like you, that I know what the community values, and that I fit in. Because displaying contempt is presenting an argument. It's asking the insiders to consider our worth, put ourselves up for judgment as to whether, you know, we truly belong. We ask to be judged if we have the right knowledge. Knowledge like PHP is an objectively bad language. Look at all the vulnerabilities in it, how bad everything written in it is. But this isn't just pointing out that we think PHP is bad. It's also saying that we know that PHP users are incompetent. After all, if they were competent, they'd be able to use good languages, languages like Python, or Ruby, or C, any of the appropriate languages. And these are the values that we hold. They're the right words. They're the right ways of showing that we should be welcomed here with all of you. But are they the right words? Before I moved to New Zealand, I lived in Calgary in Canada, and I was at a meetup. And this was a fairly large meetup, say 150 to 200 people. And this was in a pub with a big multi-level atrium. And at the beginning, like most meetups, they had a space for job advertisements. You know, this is pretty standard stuff. You would have seen this at any meetup here. And someone stood up and said, "We're looking for .NET developers." And Calgary at the time is an oil and gas town, which means lots of big companies. This is generally Windows-based infrastructure. So .NET's really big and really important. And I shouted out into the darkness, "Get a real language." Can you imagine doing that in front of 150 people? And there I was, doing that thing. And I could make any number of excuses for it, but it all came down to my thinking that it was acceptable, because the culture I existed in thought it was okay. And I felt like I was an outsider there. I'd never been to this meetup before. I'd never been to any meetup before. So I needed to show that I belonged, that I wasn't an imposter. But why? Well, let's go back further to how I was allowed into programming in the first place. One of the earliest narratives we're introduced to in tech is the idea of passion as our indicator of belonging. We idolize passion, consider it to be a critical requirement in hiring and our coworkers. Because being passionate in our culture means spending all the time you can at your computer, doing programming, doing hacking, thinking computer. Because we've culturally bought into that idea of the 10,000-hour problem, more computer is better computer. Which leads to this idea of the self-taught narrative, which is the idea that anyone who's taught themselves to code, taught themselves to do highly technical things, is going to be better at it because they wanted it more than someone who just went to university or just took a class. It glorifies us as self-taught geniuses, lone geniuses. We bootstrapped ourselves into advanced knowledge through our own ability, our own gumption, our own intellect. So when I started, like really started, I picked a language. And I had been smart enough and organized to be born to a father who programmed. So I had access to computers and books from a very young age. And as a result, I was on the internet from a very young age because of my excellent choice in lineage. So I got to see examples of what languages I should be using. So I started out with Perl. And with Perl, I started out writing web apps. This was the late 90s. And when I started coding, most of the web app code was in Perl. And there were places like Matt's Script Archive, to really date myself, that had programs that you could download and set up and run. And I was writing exceedingly bad web apps, but I was allowed to write them. They weren't an indication ever that the language was bad, just that I was young and really bad at programming, but passionate, driven, learning all by myself. And the broader community rewarded that with acceptance and help. I took that self-taught narrative and I did succeed at it. But what I had done was learned a blessed language. Like C, Perl is considered to be a real language, a good language, well, at the time. And by using it, I was considered to be a real programmer. But I can draw an identical self-taught narrative, someone who started out editing HTML and CSS like I did to adapt existing websites, who learned enough to make simple changes to the apps themselves, you know, adding little features and tweaks, who learned more than that, able to make deep and complex changes, changing fundamental aspects of the programs that they were working with. Eventually, getting to the point where they were a programmer who could start a new project from nothing and make something unique and cool. Someone who followed the exact same self-taught narrative I had, but used PHP. Now think about that. I said PHP earlier, and the first words that jump to mind in our culture are bad, or insecure, or swear words. But this person did everything I did in exactly the same way, walked the same path to get to knowledge, just with a different language, one that wasn't blessed by our culture as acceptable. Their self-taught narrative was erased because, as we covered earlier, we believe PHP users are incompetent. Not because they are or are not bad programmers, but because we believe anyone good at programming would be using a different language. That they would know better. And this isn't an archetype. This isn't someone I've made up. Many people came up to me after I wrote about contempt culture and told me this was their story. A story that was identical to mine, except for that one exceedingly trivial difference, that they used PHP instead of Perl. So why do we do this? Well, it all comes down to bias. And bias isn't necessarily a bad thing. It just means our predisposition to looking at things. We all have lots of harmless biases. For instance, I am biased towards macOS. There is nothing objectively better about macOS. I've just been using it for 15 years, and the longer I've used it, the more it's changed me, the more it's just become normal. Using Linux or Windows imparts the same kind of bias. It becomes the background against which we look at problems. Because being in a group biases you towards that group. That group becomes normal. It's what's around you all day, every day. It's like the light. It just is. So let's talk about people coming into our communities and how our biases affect that. Let's talk about some archetypes, Bob and Rakesh. They're the same age, have identical CVs, identical sets of skills. First, we sit down with Bob. And Bob is great. We get along right away. Bob grew up in New Zealand. He laughs along with us as we joke about school experiences. He knows all our jokes. He gets them. He makes this great crack about calling cloud servers ghost chips. We pitch tech questions at Bob, and we can see how he's thinking straight away, because we've already meshed so well. He didn't get all the answers right, but that doesn't matter, because we can see how he got there. And, you know, we would have made the same mistakes, so we can see how he'll just pick everything up. He'll grow. Bob's great. We like Bob. And then we sit down with Rakesh, and it just doesn't click. We can't get that rapport going. Rakesh didn't grow up in New Zealand, and while his English is impeccable, he's just not laughing at our jokes. Every clever reference ends in an awkward silence. So, what do we have? We have the CV. We focus more on it. We try to find common ground. We grill him hard. And we write down everything he gets wrong. But because we never found that rapport, we never started to see how he thinks. We don't see why he got answers wrong, just that he got them wrong. All we can see is that he doesn't know what we need him to know. And the interview ends and Rakesh falls off our short list. He just doesn't know the tech, we say. He's not a culture fit, we say. He's just too junior for what we need. So we hire Bob. And as I said, Bob and Rakesh have identical CVs, identical sets of skills. All that was different was how we reacted to them. This has been documented in numerous studies. You should go Google that. But say we did hire Rakesh. We still don't know how he thinks or how he'll learn. We still think he's too junior. So we watch him. We're still trying. We're trying to learn how he thinks, how he's going to perform, how he'll grow, how he's fitting in. And every time, let's say, he gets up to play ping pong, we watch and we count them all. And eventually, it's a performance review time and we bring it up. You know, he's playing too much ping pong. He's too junior to be away from his work like that. He needs to focus more. But we also hired Bob. Bob's great. And he plays even more ping pong than Rakesh does, but we don't see it. It's just Bob, you know? That's how Bob blows off steam. You know he's thinking the whole time. He's chewing on that hard problem. And he'll get back to his desk and be more effective. Right? We know Bob. We know how he thinks, how he learns. We can see the ideas he'll have, how he got there, because he fits in brilliantly. And this is bias to what's normal, to what we already know, to what is consistent with our world. And crucially, we do it without recognizing that we do. So we see Bob as more deserving, Rakesh as less deserving. Because Bob fits what we already know coding and technical skill looks like. Because Bob is normal. And there's some other tests of belonging we impose upon our community. There's others, like the deep usability of our tools. And we see this when we laud the command line. It's like the only interface that real programmers use, right? And we refer to GUIs as point and drool, or Fisher-Price. And those were real terms I've used consistently to describe GUIs. But this is contempt of environments that work to make computing more accessible, that have fewer barriers to adoption. But there's nothing magical or more advanced about the command line. So, why is it that we consider a deeply hostile user interface from the mid-1970s, meant for printers, to be superior to interfaces that have undergone human user computer interface testing, research, have been examined by user interface experts, that have been tested? Well, it's because the command line is unscrutable. It's because it's from the 1970s. It's because it's difficult. And the more difficult a thing is to use, the more it demonstrates mastery, superiority, but also adherence to what we consider normal, which is an expression of our power. It's a way we gatekeep when we sneer, oh, you don't use the command line? As a dev, this has made teaching people to program on Windows massively harder, because these tools that we're using drip with contempt. They barely work on Windows, because we've built them to resist, actively resist, being used in accessible environments. And this is awful. It poisons the legitimate reasons we have to use the command line. Excellent reasons. Some tasks are considerably easier on the command line. But we heap scorn on it, on those who do not use it. We poison our ability to show those other approaches, to give new solutions to people's problems. So let's go back to PHP. Why is PHP so hated? And a lot of the reasons that I get given is that the code written in PHP is insecure, the code is bad. But that's not the reason. The real reason is, let's look at the late 1990s, when PHP was just a few years old. So PHP is eating hard into developer mindshare for building websites. It's making it easier. It's getting more and more people involved in the web. More and more people are programming. This was deeply eroding Perl as the language of the web. And this was because PHP is easier. It's really easy to bring up Apache and just get it to run PHP. It was really easy to get a shared web host that would run PHP. It was really easy to just inline some HTML and have it just work. But these people weren't coming from our existing communities. They didn't obey our existing power structures. Maybe they were never even interested in tech before they learned about PHP. They were newcomers. So PHP became not real. People who used it were excluded, told that they weren't real, told they weren't real programmers. And you've probably heard this, like scripting. It's not programming. But these people still wanted to make things. So they shared their code, code that didn't have habits that were considered secure. So PHP earned a reputation of insecure, not because it was insecure, but because users were excluded, which fulfills its own prophecy of being bad. And PHP is so bad, that the biggest and most influential website in the world, Facebook, is written in it. It is so bad that the most important chat system that we have today, Slack, is written in it. So when we say that PHP is an objectively bad language, what we're saying is that our culture thinks it's bad, taking a subjective viewpoint from history and making it an objective cultural ideal. And I'm old enough to remember when Rails was released. And wow, did we heap contempt on that. Active Record did everything wrong in terms of database access from our perspective, like no foreign key constraints and doing sorting in app. This was terrible design. It was so slow. But without Rails, you wouldn't have GitHub. We wouldn't have Twitter or Ravelry or a myriad of other important and influential digital artifacts. Our lives are fundamentally changed by what Rails enabled. Because Rails made things easier. It didn't matter that database integrity was compromised in the beginning. It mattered that it enabled people to do new things more easily. It enabled us to grow and met vast swaths of contempt for it. We're doing it to JavaScript, where front-end coding isn't real coding, where we make fun of the rapid pace of JavaScript frameworks, as though researching the state of the art in user interface tooling is somehow beneath us. Why do we do this? JavaScript is extremely accessible. You can run it in your browser, and everyone's got a browser. Because the people doing it aren't always like us. They're coming from other backgrounds. They care about users, user experiences, all in a way that we have decided is far beneath us. There's so many examples to choose from. This is just a few. There's Dijkstra saying, "It is practically impossible to teach good programming to students that have had a prior exposure to BASIC. As potential programmers, they are mentally mutilated beyond hope of regeneration." Dijkstra is a luminary. He came up with the algorithm for performing fast graph traversals. And he deeply perpetuated contempt culture. But BASIC was one of the first languages I ever touched. I wouldn't be here without it. But it's held in contempt because it makes access easier. Because being easier means it undermines the power of those who already belong. It puts the previously powerful in the position where their belonging is questioned, where they have to prove once again that they belong, that they deserve to be here. And all of these things add up to the falsehood that is meritocracy. We tell ourselves that we're judging people on their merits, the languages they know or the patterns they've mastered. But when Bob is no more skilled than Rakesh, when PHP is held in such low regard, what we are judging is not technical skill, merely similarity to ourselves. We think those closest to us have stronger technical skills, but only because we see ourselves in them. We understand how they think, act, and will grow. Because their similarity reinforces that our choices were correct. Their similarity reinforces our power and our sense of belonging. And none of these things will individually feel wrong. none of it will feel like we've made the wrong choice. It always feels like we are making good decisions. But these decisions all add up to very exclusionary outcomes. Our actions decided that people don't deserve to belong. We didn't intend for it to happen, but it still happened. It's done. We did that. And as a result, we have founded our entire communities on insecurity, doubt, fear. We build the fear that we won't know the right shared knowledge, that we will be a fraud, that we won't laugh at the right jokes, that we'll have used the wrong tools, that we don't even use the right tools. As a result, we always live in fear. And our communities build that fear. Imposter syndrome is a big deal in tech culture, and it's easy to find all around us. I'm struggling with imposter syndrome right here, right now, in front of all of you. Believing that I deserve to be here can be hard, not just here on stage, here at the conference, here speaking. And almost everyone I talk to feels this way. Feels like they don't really belong here. Like they'd be real if they only knew more about compiler theory or databases or back-end programming or CSS or breaking things or writing assembly or whatever. The common thread isn't a real technology that we should be using, but that we judge ourselves against unattainable archetypes of what realness is. So when someone knows something that we don't, when something doesn't work as expected, and we have to go ask, this is terrifying, because it shows we don't know something. And not knowing means we don't belong. Because if we were real, we would have known. And for me, every day has that anxiety. What don't I know? What should I have said? What do people actually really think of me? What would a real DevOps know? And we all walk on that razor's edge of not fitting the right mold, of being seen as ignorant of the correct knowledge, which leaves us afraid that we will be seen as a fraud because we no longer meet expectations, leaving us in fear of the judgment, in fear of asking, that we will be mocked for knowing PHP or for doing front-end development, that we will no longer be real. And when realness is never a mark of can write programs but or can hack, but only fits existing expectations, we fear that expectations will shift and we will no longer be welcome. And so, under contempt culture, we are constantly required to reassert that our knowledge is valid, that we are correct, that outside ideas are wrong, that outsiders themselves are wrong, that we're not naive and helpless like the devs, that we can actually build things unlike those lesser ops people, that we know better than to write PHP or Java or use Windows, that we're not a designer who exists only to make things pretty, that we're not a lowly user, that most hated class in all of computing, because we are real. We're not an imposter. And we act this way, and we fight for our realness because imposter syndrome is a desired effect. Let that sink in. Our culture, our communities demand that we have imposter syndrome, constantly reassert that we belong because we must be better than outsiders, better than non-programmers, better than users. We must know more, because only then do we deserve to belong. And so, we push down others to elevate ourselves. We show that we are unbounded by social norms of politeness or respect. We say that we are wizards, rock stars, ninjas, my personal favorite, the 10x engineer. We posture as though we are good enough, while never being permitted to believe it. Everything I've covered so far has been an analysis of a system. And we're technologists. We love to analyze and dismantle systems. This is an analysis of the choices that we make and how we keep choosing to make them. An analysis of what refusing to acknowledge the system costs us, does to us. Where we choose to keep doing this to ourselves, to use contempt culture as the driving forces in our communities. We choose to do it when we claim PHP is awful, or when we bash Java. I saw a speaker do that at PyCon 2015. We choose to do it when we sneer at front-end development, call it not real programming. We choose to do it when our tools barely work on Windows. And seeing this system is so much harder than most, because the natural reaction to this being pointed out is to deny that we have done it. Because people who do these things must be bad people. And I'm not a bad person, so I must never have done these things, right? And that defensiveness is normal. I was defensive when these things were pointed out to me because I felt bad about it. I felt like I was a bad person. And in so many ways, I've never stopped feeling like I'm a bad person. And every time I think of that night in Calgary, I feel ashamed, so ashamed. And this is a natural response to suddenly looking at everything you've ever done in a new and deeply unflattering light. A light that makes us feel like bad people, like we have done irreparable harm. We have done irrevocable harm. We can never undo the past. But that does not make us bad people. But it does mean we have done things with negative outcomes. It means we have perpetuated contempt culture because it was all around us. It was who we were because it was normal. But lack of awareness does not mean a lack of responsibility. We have still done these things. We have made our industries exclusionary and hostile. But now we have awareness. We can see what we've done. And in awareness of what we have done, in seeing with a new light, we are given a new choice. We can choose to ignore everything we've ever done, choose to ignore that our culture has negative outcomes, that our culture, by its very nature, gives all of us imposter syndrome all the time. We can choose to make ourselves feel bad, to regret the pasts that we cannot change, the things that we cannot undo. Or we can choose to keep believing that our actions do not have consequences. Or we can choose to change. We can accept responsibility for our actions and ask ourselves, is this who I want to be? And accepting that responsibility is difficult. It requires admitting that we have done these things that we are not proud of. Facing our shame, that for all of our intentions, we have done harm. It requires seeking new viewpoints, understanding new tools, finding new ways of thinking. This will be tools like the code of conduct, which came about because of people deciding to stop perpetuating this system. It means considering that what we do is not a demonstration of our mastery or intellect, but is an enabler. To think on how what we do helps others. Which is, for me, the understanding that coding is not the most important part, that breaking is not the most important part, that running it is not the most important part, that we must treat other fields and other skills with respect, value their contributions, that achieving users' goals must always be our goal. It means PHP is never ew, but actually the beginning of hey, show me this cool thing that you've made, means that from today onward, you have a choice. I have described a system, and now you are aware not only of what you have done, but what you can do. You can choose to help make this a better culture, better industry, a better community, a community where we all belong, one where we always ask, is this really who we want to be? Thank you.